Concurrency control is the working concept that is required for controlling and managing the concurrent execution of the database operations, thus avoiding the inconsistencies that happen in the database system. Thus, for maintaining the concurrency of the database, we have the concurrency control protocols. So what are protocols? These are nothing but set of rules that we follow. If you follow the discipline, there will be no problem in the system. So if you follow these protocols, there will be no inconsistency occurs into the system. Let us see now what are different concurrency protocols in our syllabus. The university has mentioned there are two, that is log-based protocol and timestamp protocol. Concurrency control protocols ensures all the properties of transaction like atomicity, consistency, isolation, durability, and it also maintains serializability of the concurrent execution of the database transactions. Therefore, there are protocols categorized into two, that is log-based concurrency control protocol, and second is timestamp-based concurrency control protocol. Let us understand, what do you mean by log-based protocol? In this type of protocol, any transaction cannot read or write data until it acquires appropriate lock on it. It means if you perform a lock on a particular data item on which you want to work on, then only you can perform the operation into the system. Otherwise, you can't. So this protocol always acquires a lock on a data item on which you want to do modifications, so that another transaction will not going to disturb you till your transaction perform that updation. So there are two types of locks available in log-based protocol, that is called as shared lock, and another lock is called as exclusive lock. Shared lock is also known as a read-only lock. In shared lock, the data item can only be read by the transaction, but you cannot update it. You can only read the data item, but you cannot update it. It can be shared between n number of transactions. That lock can be shared in between n number of transactions, because when the transaction holds a shared lock, then it can't update that data item. It means you are only going to read the data item value. You are not going to update it. So share lock can be used by many transactions on the same data item at the same time. That is possible. Then another lock is called as exclusive lock. In the exclusive lock, the data item can be both read as well as written by the transaction. It means that if you hold a exclusive lock on any particular data item, if a transaction holds exclusive lock on any data item, then that transaction has a right to perform read as well as write on that data item. It means that you can read as well as you can update that data item if you have exclusive lock on any particular data item. But the thing is that if a particular transaction holds an exclusive lock on a particular data item, then other transaction cannot acquire the lock on that particular data item. So the lock is exclusive, and in this lock, multiple transactions do not modify the same data items simultaneously. To understand this, both the types of locks, you can refer this diagram, that is called as lock compatibility matrix. In lock compatibility matrix, the columns, if you see on column side, you have the different types of locks, shared and exclusive. On the row side also, you have the different types of lock, that is shared and exclusive. This shows the state of the lock and lock request type. You can go for row side, right? Now, at the cross section of shared, if this particular transaction perform shared lock on a data item. Can another transaction also place the shared lock on it? Yes, it is allowed. So it means that in between shared lock and another transaction shared lock, sharing is possible. Many transaction can acquire shared lock on the same data item. That's why here it is written yes. But suppose if someone has exclusive lock on a data item, no other transaction is allowed to perform shared lock or exclusive lock on it. So that's why it is written no here as well as no here, as well as here also, because this particular transaction has exclusive lock, so and the another transaction wants to apply for a shared lock, that is not possible. If any particular data item is locked by any transaction because of the exclusive lock, then no other transaction is allowed to apply or acquire any lock on that particular data item. So please let me know, have you understood what do you mean by lock and what are different types of locks? There are two types of lock, the shared lock and exclusive lock. Shared lock is also called as read-only lock. In shared lock, the data item can only be read, but it cannot perform write operation on the data item. The shared lock can be shared between different transactions, because when the transaction holds a shared lock, then it can't update the data. It can only perform a read operation on the data item. Second type of lock is exclusive lock. In the exclusive lock, the data item can be read or write both by the transaction. But the transaction which holds the data item using exclusive lock, only that particular transaction can perform read or write. But other transactions will not get any type of lock on that particular data item till the current transaction which holds the exclusive lock or releases that particular lock from it. Yes, have you understood, student, what is shared lock and exclusive lock? Please write your answer in the chat box. Okay. You understood what you mean by shared lock and exclusive lock. Then we'll go to C, different protocols available in lock-based category. There are four types of lock protocols available in the database system. The first one is called a simplistic lock protocol. Second one is pre-claiming lock protocol. Third is two-phase lock protocol. And fourth is strict two-phase lock protocol. Let us see now one by one. The first protocol is simplistic lock protocol. It is the simplest way of locking the data while the transaction is happening. Simplistic lock based protocol allows all the transactions to get the lock on the data item before performing insert or delete or update on that data item. It will unlock the data item after completing the transaction. So in simplistic lock protocol, this particular protocol allows all the transactions to perform lock on it, perform before performing any modification on the data item, and it releases all the locks after completing the transaction. That is called as simple lock protocol. The another one is pre-claiming lock protocol. It means the claim of lock should be predefined. So before modifying or before doing anything on the data item, you must acquire a lock on that particular data item. In pre-claiming lock protocol, evaluate the transaction to list of data items on which they need locks. So in initial phase only, you have to first identify the data items on which you want to perform the locks or you want to perform the modification. Before initiating and execution of the transaction, it requests DBMS software for the locks on all those data items, and it acquires that locks. If all locks are granted, then this protocol allows the transaction to begin. When the transaction is completed, it releases all the locks. If all the locks are not granted, suppose, then this protocol allows the transaction to roll back and waits until all locks are granted. So what is the difference between the previous one, that is simplistic lock protocol, and pre-claiming lock protocol? A simple difference is that simplistic lock protocol allows the transaction to execute or to begin simultaneously in the process of acquiring the lock. But whereas in pre-claiming lock protocol, it allows the transaction to start or execute if and only if the grant of the lock is allowed by the system. Otherwise, it won't allow you to execute that transaction. It cancels the transaction by applying the rollback operation and waits until all the locks are granted. So you can understand by this particular diagram, all locks are attained, then at the beginning only, then here your transaction started, right? And when it started releasing the lock, when all locks are, I mean, you can say they can be released only when the transaction comes to end. So the release operation of locks is performed when the transaction gets ended. Let us see. This is very important. This may be asked for 5 marks in your short notes in final exam. Two-phase locking protocol divides the execution phase of the entire transaction into 3 parts. When the transaction is executing, it divides that transaction execution phase into 3 different parts. The first important part is when the execution of the transaction starts. It seeks permission for the lock it requires on data items. Second part is the transaction acquires all the locks in second parts. In third phase or in third part, it started as soon as the transaction releases its first lock. Means the third phase in this particular two-phase lock protocol starts only when it releases the first lock on any data item. In the third phase, the transaction cannot demand any further locks or any new locks on any data items. Once that third phase is started, it is only meant for releasing the locks. It only releases the acquired locks in the first, also in the second phase. So it releases all the locks that have been acquired in the second phase. First phase, when the transaction starts and it seeks the permission for the lock it requires. In second phase, it actually acquires the locks. In third phase, it started releasing the locks, right? So it means that there are two phases in this entire process. One is called as growing phase and another is called as shrinking phase. In growing phase, you can only acquire the locks, whereas in shrinking phase, you can only release the locks that you have acquired in the transaction lifecycle. Okay, so let us see by this particular diagram, let us understand the two-phase lock protocol concept. So your transaction begins here, your transaction ends here. Your first phase starts when the transaction is started executing and it asks for the permission. Okay, this is your first phase. Your second phase is here. In second phase, you are going to acquire all the locks and the transaction life cycle starts, and at last it comes to an end when it started releasing the third phase. In third phase, it started releasing the lock, Yeah. So when the first lock is released, your transaction entered into phase three, wherein you are actually releasing all the locks that you have acquired in the second phase. So lock release process will happen here. Okay, so you can consider that the entire two-phase lock protocol is divided into growing phase and shrinking phase. In the growing phase, a new lock on the data item may be acquired by the transaction, but none can be released. It means that this particular phase is only meant for acquiring the new locks, whereas the another phase, that is called a shrinking phase, in the shrinking phase, existing locks held by the transaction may be released, but no new locks can be acquired. So the job of shrinking phase is to release the locks and not to acquire new locks. To understand this, we will see one example of a schedule. In the below example, if the lock conversion is allowed, then the following phases can be happened as follows. First is upgrading of lock, like from shared lock on data item A to exclusive lock on data item A. It means this is possible in into growing phase, is allowed in the growing phase, whereas downgrading of locks, it means you are going from exclusive lock to the shared lock, must be done in the shrinking phase. Let us see this particular schedule, wherein there are two transactions, T1 and T2. Before performing anything on data items A, B, and C, in the growing phase, we are going to first apply or acquire the locks on the data item. So you can see the first instruction in transaction T1, it is lock S on account A. So this lock S indicates that it is a shareable lock. S stands for shareable and X stands for exclusive lock. Okay. So you have transaction T1 acquired shared lock on data item A. In second instruction, transaction T also wants to perform shared lock on data item A. That is allowed and it has been given. In third statement, transaction T1 now wants to perform exclusive lock on data item B. So it is also granted because no other transaction has already performed exclusive lock on data item B. So it is also granted. But there is no exclusive lock performed after this. You can see in statement 3, you are performing some another task. Once data item B is locked due to exclusive lock, no further locks is allowed on data item B. In the fourth statement, you can see up till this first four instructions, only growing phase is there, means lock has been allotted, lock has been granted. From statement ID 4 to 9, unlocking is done. It means the releasing of the lock is going to be performed. Unlock on data item A, then transaction T2 perform lock on exclusive lock on data item C, unlock B by transaction T1, then unlock A, and then unlock C by transaction T2. So here, how this growing and shrinking phase happens. In transaction P1, you see it carefully. In transaction T1, the growing phase is started at the first instruction and it ends before this fifth instruction, that is index number 4. So you can say that 0 to 3, all the instructions are in the growing phase, right? Growing phase covered step number 1 to 3. You can see this 1, 2, and 3. You can say then the shrink and the lock point is occurred at statement 3. Yeah. When the final lock was allotted in transaction T1, the lock point is ended here. This is the actual lock point for transaction T1. Right. And the for transaction T2, the growing phase is from step number 2 to step number 6. check it into transaction P2. All locks are allowed till index number 5. It means it started at index number 1, that is instruction 2, and it ends at instruction 6. So from 2 to 6, growing phase is there for transaction P2, whereas the shrinking phase is from transaction statement 8 and 9. There is a shrinking phase. So wherein you are actually releasing the locks. It is unlock A and unlock C instruction at 8th and 9th step in transaction T2. So here is the shrinking phase in this particular schedule. Where is the lock point for transaction P2? It is at instruction number 6. When you actually perform the last lock operation, that is at instruction number 6. If you count the number of lines, you perform exclusive lock and add on data item C at instruction number 6. So this is the lock point for transaction P2. Okay, so here we understood what strict phase two-phase lock protocol. The first phase of the strict two-phase lock protocol is similar to the previous protocol, that is two-phase lock protocol. In the first phase, after acquiring all the locks, the transaction continues to execute normally. But the only difference between two-phase lock protocol and strict two-phase lock protocol is that in strict two-phase lock protocol does not release a lock after using it. Right. In strict two-phase lock protocol, wait until the whole transaction commit. In between, it will not allow you to release. So always wait for the whole transaction to commit, and then it releases all the locks at the same time. Rather than releasing the lock one by one, it releases all the locks at the same time. So the strict two-phase lock protocol does not have a shrinking phase. There is only one phase, growing phase, but there is no shrinking phase. Here you can see that there is a straight line which goes when the transaction ends. It means that all the locks which are there in this particular phase are released at once. So there is only growing phase, second phase, and there is no shrinking phase. Because of this, it does not have cascade aborts like a two-phase lock protocol. You can check the abort diagram in two-phase lock protocol and strict two-phase lock. This is a diagram for two-phase lock protocol. It is, in first phase, it is acquiring the lock. In the last phase, it is releasing the lock one by one. See this line. This is slanting, right? But here, there is a straight line in two-phase lock protocol. Strict two-phase lock protocol. Here, it is a straight line. It means all the locks have been released at the same time. That is the only difference. Again, in the growing phase, you can acquire the lock, but you cannot release the lock. But there is more similarity and a slight difference between two-phase lock protocol and strict two-phase lock protocol. This ends the timestamp ordering protocol. The timestamp ordering protocol is used to order the transaction based on their timestamp. Timestamp is nothing but the time given by the CPU for a transaction to complete its execution. Right? What is timestamp? It is just a time that has been given by CPU to perform the transaction to its execution. Right? The order of the transaction is nothing but the ascending order of its creation. So how you will come to know which transaction is started, which transaction is started later, which transaction is started after that? So there is a sequence of transactions happening in the system. And definitely, a transaction which entered into the system has lower timestamp because it's already started, its instruction, some instruction already executed. And if you check the time required by that particular transaction to complete, it would be definitely less than the next transaction. And suppose the second transaction which entered into the system, this timestamp should be definitely less than the transaction which entered later on.
later, right? So transaction T3, suppose it started later, transaction T2 into the system, the timestamp for transaction T2 would be less than the timestamp of transaction T3. So it means that the transaction which enters into the system, its timestamp is definitely more than the transaction which are actually executing into the system. So the order of is always maintained in the ascending order fashion. All the transactions are maintained in the ascending order of their creation. The priority of the older transaction, now which one is considered as older transaction and which one is considered as the new transaction. The transaction, suppose T1 entered into the system first, then T2 and then T3 entered into the system say. So which one is the oldest transaction into this and which one is the younger transaction into this? Please reply in the chat box. Suppose there are three transactions, T1, T2 and T3. Entered in the system in this order, T1 entered first, then T2 and then T3. So which one is older transaction here and which one is younger transaction? Please reply. Janvi, there everybody is saying T1 is older transaction whereas T3 is the younger transaction. Good. So the transaction which entered first into the system becomes older, whereas the transaction freshly entered into the system is considered younger transaction. Okay. And the answer is correct. Okay. So the priority of the older transaction is always higher into the system. That's why it executes first into the system. To determine the timestamp of the transaction, this protocol uses the system time or logical counter. So it means that this protocol always uses system time to actually count how much time is needed by the particular transaction to execute, right? So what is the time needed by T1, what is the time needed by T2 and T3? That will be calculated by the system time minus the time utilized by a transaction. So the transaction, older transaction always has the higher priority and it always allows the older transaction to execute. Like in a log-based protocol, basically log-based protocol is used to manage the order between conflicting pairs among the transaction at the execution time. It basically used for conflicting pairs of transaction at the execution time. But timestamp ordering protocol starts working immediately the transaction is created into the system. So it basically works on the timestamp. Right. Let's assume that there are two transactions T1 and T2. Suppose transaction T1 has entered into the system at time 007 times and transaction T2 has entered the system at 009 times. Then we can say that T1 has the highest priority among these two transactions. So it executes first as it entered the system first. The timestamp ordering protocol also maintain the timestamp of last read and write operation on the data item. So it means that it always calculate two types of timestamp, that is called as read timestamp and write timestamp. So what do you mean by read timestamp? It is the timestamp required to perform a read operation. Write timestamp to complete that write operation on the data item, right? So basic steps that we follow in the timestamp ordering protocol are as follows. First important step is that suppose there is a transaction T1 or TI wants to perform a redex operation on a data item X, then we look for two things. One is we'll always check if the right timestamp for this particular statement W_TS of X indicates that if the right timestamp of data item X is greater than the timestamp of transaction TI, then the operation must be rejected. That particular operation must be rejected. Second thing that we check, again, if the right timestamp of data item X is less than or equal to timestamp of transaction Ti, then the operation is executed. Timestamp of all the data items are updated later after this operations. So two conditions are very important. We have to look for the right timestamp of data item X. If it is greater than timestamp of transaction Ti, it allows you to execute this particular operation on data item X if and only if the right timestamp of transaction T, right timestamp of data item X must be less than the timestamp of transaction Ti. Then only it allowed you to execute this operation. Otherwise, it rejects that operation. That's it. Now, for second thing that we always check for another instruction for a transaction, if the transaction wants Ti wants to perform a write X operation, it wants to update that data item X. Then again, we check two conditions. That is, if the timestamp of current transaction Ti is less than the read timestamp of Tx, then the operation is rejected. Okay. If the timestamp of Ti is less than the write timestamp of data item X, then the operation is again rejected and Ti is rolled back. Otherwise, the operation is executed. It means that here also, if any transaction wants to perform write X operation on a data item X, then the write timestamp of data item X must be less than the timestamp of that particular transaction. Then only it is allowed to perform read or write operation on that particular data item. So here all these notations are used, where TS of Ti denotes the timestamp of transaction Ti, or R underscore TS of X denotes the read timestamp of data item X, whereas W underscore TS of X denotes the write timestamp of data item X. So if you read these conditions carefully, you will come to know that any transaction is allowed to perform a read or write operation on that particular data item X if and only if the write timestamp of data item X must be less than or equal to the timestamp of the transaction Ti. Any doubts, or have you understood this particular concept, student? Timestamp ordering protocol. So there are two things that we are going to do. That is, read X operation by transaction Ti and write X operation by transaction Ti. When it allows you to perform this operation and when it won't allow you to perform that particular operation, that you need to check into timestamp ordering protocol. So have you understood, students? So here we checked the write timestamp of transaction data item X. If it is greater, it reject the transaction. It reject the particular operation. It allows you to execute read X operation or write X operation if and only if the write timestamp of data item X must be less than the timestamp of transaction Ti. Now let us see the last point of this timestamp ordering protocol. That is, what are different advantages and disadvantages of timestamp ordering protocol? First advantage is that timestamp ordering protocol ensures the serializability of all the transaction schedule, since the precedence graph is as follows. Here you can see the transaction with lower timestamp is allowed to execute first, and then the transaction with larger timestamp. So because of this, it always ensures the serializability of all the transactions happening into the concurrent system. Second advantage is that timestamp ordering protocol ensures freedom from the deadlock. That means no transaction waits for another transaction in the system for that particular data. Deadlock occurs into the system only when, if there are say two transactions T1 and T2, T1 wants to access data item which is held by or held by the transaction T2, and T2 wants to work on a data item which is held by transaction T1, and no transaction wants to release the lock on the those data items, and no transaction proceed further. So that situation creates a deadlock in the database system. So that deadlock will never occur in this particular protocol, timestamp ordering protocol. The third point is the disadvantage of timestamp ordering protocol. But the schedule may not be recoverable and may not even be cascade free. So this protocol does not ensure that the particular schedule is recoverable or